Hi everyone, today is a really special day.
ASIA featuring John Payne.
30 years ago, Aqua by the band ASIA was released. They don't know so who can stop the rain. That was my first ASIA album. I can't believe it's 30 years. It's also 40 years since the release of the first ASIA album. And we're out on tour doing both albums with a double anniversary tour. It was the heat of the moment. I'm really, really looking forward to it. Heat of the moment. Cheers, everybody.
Test. This is Play That Rock and Roll. I'm your host, Joseph K., and like the song at the start says, just call me Joe. Today, we have another guest, and that is John Payne. John Payne took over lead vocals for the band ASIA in 1992 and recorded with Jeff Downs up until 2006 when Jeff reunited the original lineup. Since then, John has toured and recorded with his own band, ASIA featuring John Payne. This summer, ASIA featuring John Payne is going out on their double anniversary tour, which starts this week. And it is celebrating both the 40th anniversary of ASIA's 1982 debut and also the 30th anniversary of 1992's Aqua, which was John's first album with ASIA. This is a great idea for a live show. I've seen a couple of bands play one album all the way through in concert, but I don't think I've seen any band attempt to play two. So this is a great opportunity for fans to hear some deep cuts from ASIA's discography alongside ASIA's biggest radio hits. So in this interview, we talk about what ASIA's debut and Aqua both mean to John personally, what songs he is most looking forward to playing, how he is building the set list, his experiences of recording the Aqua album, and he even shares some memories of his friend Tony Lewis. Tony was the lead singer of the Outfield, and he passed away unexpectedly in 2020. John and Tony had become close friends and tour mates in recent years, so it was really nice to hear John reflect on that friendship. Due to some reception issues, this interview is a little shorter than usual, but John did say he'd be happy to come back for a part two, and since ASIA featuring John Payne has a new album on the horizon, I think that's a great idea, and I will follow up with him then. That said, I need to thank John for his time and for sharing all of these great stories. Go see ASIA featuring John Payne this summer. It's going to be a great show. You can find tour dates and get tickets at asiafeaturingjohnpayne.com. ASIA featuring John Payne is also on Facebook and Twitter. On Facebook, facebook.com/asia.featuring.john.payne. And on Twitter, @asia_featuring_john_payne. So without further ado, here's my conversation with vocalist, bassist, and frontman of ASIA, John Payne. The first time I saw you in concert was at Wisconsin State Fair back in 2017 when you were doing the Rock Pack tour with Lou and Steve Augeri and Fee Waybill and Bobby Kimball. And I got to tell you, that was a great show. That was one of my favorite shows of that summer. And I remember that someone posted some funny pictures of you guys visiting the bronze Fonz statue in Milwaukee. Do you have any memories of that?
With Henry Winkler,
yeah.
I remember doing that just by the side of the river there.
Right.
Yeah. In fact, we're coming back to, obviously, to Wisconsin State Fair again.
Yes.
And then we were supposed to do it last year. I think it was last year. And we sound checked on this beautiful day. We were doing the show with Foreigner. and the storm came in and like trees were being pulled out the ground. And it went crazy. I think that last year. I'm sure it was last year.
Yeah, and they had to cancel, right?
Yeah.
Or did Foreigner end up playing?
I think we canceled. The rain came in and the storm came in. Then the rain stopped. And the guy said, well, we don't Foreigner on too late just in case. He goes, I was like, please, can we play? And he goes, you'll still get paid. I said, no, it's not. Yeah, getting right. paid is really good because we have to pay for the flights and the band and all this stuff. But to go that way and not to play is wrong. And it's you know, I still do this. And I started this doing it because I love it. And if you can have a career and a life doing this, what's better?
Absolutely. It's so interesting that you say that because Wisconsin State Fair always has bad weather for something, because years ago I was supposed to see Lou Graham open for, I think, Steppenwolf, and the same thing. Rain yeah. came, they canceled him, he couldn't play, but the headliner did, and that's why I've only had a chance to see Lou when he was with you, so I'm glad you guys came through a couple years later. And I do have tickets to see you with Kansas.
Oh, good. Well, yeah. Come and say hi.
Absolutely. Absolutely. Would love to do that. So before we get into what you're planning for this tour, which sounds great, I want to offer you a very belated condolences for your friend Tony Lewis from the Outfield. And I only bring him up because I'm a big fan of his, and I noticed how much you've worked with him in his last years and how much you've celebrated him on social media. And unfortunately, I just don't see a lot of artists kind of posting that much about him. So as a fan of his, I just want to thank you for all that.
You know, you remind me, I still speak with his wife every month on WhatsApp. And, you know, Tony, the last thing he did for me was I was doing this record for a charity organization that I work with called Orphan Starfish, that rescue lots of trafficked and abused children. And I called Tony and said, can you sing a verse of this? Buck Dharma's singing a verse. Kelly Keegi's singing a verse. Steve Ruggieri's singing a verse. I'm doing one. So I wrote this song for this charity. And he did this song for me, and the vocal was chilling and beautiful. And then his wife calls me less than 24 hours later, said Tony passed away. Awesome. And I had such a connection with him. He's just a joker like me, so we used to mess around with Monty Python jokes and all this kind of stuff. And his wife goes, oh, will you two stop it, you're just a couple of kids. And we just giggle and stuff, you know, in the meet and greets. And he still sang in the same key. He still sang all those songs perfectly. And he was gracious enough to let me, when he joined ASIA Featuring My Good Self, that I played bass on all those big hits of his. And he was like, normally he goes, I don't want anyone else to play bass, but it's you, and you're my mate. And such a lovely, lovely man. Died far too young and very, very missed.
Well said. Yeah, thank you for that. I regretted that I didn't get a chance to see you guys play together on the tour that you were doing with them. It just looked like so much fun. And I just imagine, as you guys both being bassist vocalists, that you must have had a really good connection on that stuff.
No, we did. We did. And the connection was more than musical. The connection was our humor, and we had a very similar dry sense of humor, but very like quips back, little answers. And he was a close friend, and it just makes you realize how short life is and how not to get obsessed with minute first world problems.
Yeah, exactly.
Oh, I can't get my Xbox. Boo-hoo.
Yeah. Like, yeah, absolutely.
Someone else
okay.
Caught the other side of the world is like, well, I can't get water. I think there's a little bit of a difference.
Right. First world problems. That's a good way to put it.
Yes, exactly.
Okay.
My first world problem at the moment is the state bird of Maine.
Okay. What's wrong with what's wrong with the bird?
It's called a mosquito.
Oh.
I've been, no one else is getting bitten. And I look like a pincushion with my peachy English skin.
Yeah. You know, I vacation in northern Wisconsin every summer, and it is mosquito city up there. So I feel your pain. Literally. Okay. Well, let's talk about the tour for a little bit. So the tour you're doing this summer is a double anniversary tour, which is something I've never seen anyone attempt before, which is awesome.
And it's so funny when people say, well, you're not an original member of ASIA. Well, I actually am. I was in the original band, but I'm not a founding member of the band. And I didn't record the 1982 album. But I did 8 albums and 15 years with ASIA. So I wanted to celebrate what really made me get into the band, which was the first album.
Yeah.
And I think it's really cool to play the 1982 album and then the 1992 album and pay respect and homage. You know, I'm not trying to be one of the founding members and I don't exactly sing like John Wetton, but I've been doing those songs for years and I was asked to join this amazing band and, you know, I want to continue some of the legacy. So it seemed right to celebrate not just 92, but 82. And the 82 albums got some great songs on. One Step Closer, which I've never done before. And funny enough, Heaven on Earth on Aqua, I've never played before. So there's going to be some tracks that I've never done.
Yeah.
And that's going to be a challenge because some of them are complex. Some of them, you know, it's a set of vocally a lot of high challenging stuff. But luckily, at the moment, as of today, I can still sing them.
Yeah. How have the rehearsals been going?
They've been going great, actually. We actually rehearse at my home in Vegas.
Okay.
And it's really cool. Everyone wants to give 1,000% to these songs. And we're just a 4-piece like the original. The rehearsals are going to keep continuing, you know, because it's a lot of complex stuff, and the show will even develop along the road, so that we're going to add video to it, and I want to get some pictures back in the day, but that's what I'm out here doing, a lot of the pre-production, and I thought I couldn't do it as of today until I bought the new computer.
Oh, that sounds great. So sort of a whole multimedia thing. So yeah, it's like you're taking this anniversary thing seriously. It's not just that acknowledge a song or two, that you're diving head on in with both of these records.
It's a big milestone. It's a big milestone, 40 years of the original founding members and then 30 years of an album that actually changed my life. You know, I went from being a guy playing bars and stuff like that. And I worked with Roger Daltrey and Mike Caulfield. I did a lot of backing vocals for people. And I had a band called The Passion, actually, before, which was with Andy Nye from the Michael Schenker Band, and Clive Burr, who's sadly not with us, from Iron Maiden. And thrown into some huge shoes to fill in 1991.
Yeah.
And releasing Aqua in 92.
Yeah, Well, let's dive into Aqua in just a few minutes here. I want to ask you just a couple questions about the debut, the 40th. You've been playing songs from the ASIA debut your whole career with ASIA. Yeah. So I know the big radio hits you can play in your sleep probably at this point.
Yeah.
What are some of the songs on this record that when you play them in concert, they bring you personally the most joy because of either how you perform or how the audience responds?
Yeah, I like some of the deeper tracks, you know. It's still great, and I think bands still need to play the big hits. Now, heat of the moment and only time will tell. But right. going, you know, songs like Wildest Dreams, Cutting It Fine, and Time Again. Particularly Time Again's got like a jazz fusion thing going on. I love the challenge of those songs to actually play bass and sing them. And so the slightly deeper tracks are the ones that really bring me great joy. And then that's going to be the same because, you know, I really have to play, especially if it's a short set or if it's a festival, they want to hear just the big hits. And then, you know, a lot of my era stuff, the 8 albums I've done don't often get played very much. It's only with longer shows. But now I'm really looking forward to playing songs like Someday, Lay Down Your Arms, Heaven on Earth, off of the Aqua album. It's strange. It's strange to even think it's, yes, exactly. It's strange to even think it's 30 years.
Yeah. Yeah, that album is closer to the debut than we are to Aqua.
I know.
Isn't that, I never thought of it that way. That's frightening.
Yeah. Right.
But, you know, I think it's going to bring back a lot of memories for me playing these songs. And it'll be nice to educate maybe some people that have just heard the first album as to my tenure in the band. And Aqua was such a hard piece of work to do. I mean, every album I did with Jeff Downs was months of writing and months of studio stuff. It's not like, I'll see you later. We'd go and stay in a recording studio and live there for 3 months, like one of these residential studios, and hone and get the right performance before we rehearsed before we even tracked it. So it's going to be a trip down memory lane for me.
So when you were making that Aqua album, when you talk about songwriting, what was that process like? Did you all contribute lyrics and music, or, you know, did one person have one job and another person have another thing? Was it really collaborative, or what do you remember about how that how the songwriting
very collaborative
came
on a lot of songs. Jeff always, and I went through a lot of albums, Jeff always let me handle the lyrics I was singing.
Oh, okay.
There were a couple of songs, especially early on, that Jeff or someone else had brought to the table. But going forward, particularly in ASIA, it was a really strong writing collaboration. That I'd pick up an acoustic guitar, and Jeff would put the keyboards down, and we'd get a really good thing going. And Jeff's chord inversions and stuff were very inspiring. And then often I'd come up with a melody and the lyric. And then sometimes I'd come up with a song on acoustic guitar, or, you know, there were songs like Heaven on Earth that, you know, I bought from writing before I joined ASIA.
Oh, okay.
But it was a very collaborative process. I mean, And one thing I'll say about Jeff is that his chord inversions are really, really inspiring. So I love the songwriting process. It's magical for me.
Absolutely. And I think it turned out really well. I've been listening to this record all week, and I'm
I just
am super impressed with it. I like your era. I like the 90s era of ASIA quite a bit. I think that's one of the best things about ASIA is that it's such a big discography. But, you know, the 90s stuff, even on ARIA, Military Man and Anytime are great tracks. But what going back to Aqua, I mean, my only thought on that is the reason it couldn't have been the big hit that the debut was timing, right? I mean, 1992 was the year of grunge.
Timing.
You know, yeah. Prague had a tough time in those years, right?
Oh, we had a very tough time. And also, when, you know, we didn't have the Geffen machine that Geffen was for the first album. But
exactly.
That was very much, you know, they came off being all from big prog bands to do this rock, prog, pop band, you know, with John Wetton and Jeff Downes, there was a pop sensibility in their writing, which helped them a lot, which makes them so huge. But I think by 92, as you said, there were other musical influences, and we were seen as not the king's new clothes and not very cool at all.
And then the singles for that record are Who Will Stop the Rain and Little Rich Boy. There wasn't any music videos made in that point, right?
No, there weren't. And I don't know why. I actually think the record company started running out of money. They spent a lot of money on making the album. And then they started running out, and the promotion wasn't really strong. Who Stopped the Rain did pretty well in Europe and Germany and Switzerland particularly. And it was played quite a bit on the radio here.
Yeah.
I remember doing a lot of radio tours. But there should have been a video with it, you know.
Yeah.
It was in prime MTV time, so. Although MTV, actually, at that stage, wasn't really playing much rock.
No, it was on the decline.
So, and I think, so I think maybe if that album was 5 years earlier, it got great critical acclaim, and we toured it a lot, and it, you know, it was part of the path that enabled us to do another 7 more albums. So it was cool, and it was great. You know, we got really nice artwork on there. We paid a lot of money to get Rodney Matthews to do the cover, and I'm very happy with that cover.
I was just going to ask about that, because that keeps that great tradition of ASIA of having these, like, really eye-catching artistic album covers. You know, as a record collector, I love that. I can't put into words how much I love that kind of thing, because for years I used to put albums up on my wall, and I would have the album artwork as decoration on the wall, and then I would pull out the record and listen to it.
And when CDs came along, it kind of diminished that.
Absolutely.
I always remember as a kid, you know, you get an album, you'd open it up and you read all the sleeve notes and you play the album in the order. You know, we spent a lot of time choosing the order when the album's mastered. Now it doesn't really matter, you know.
Right.
But there was always like, we want to go from something slow into something fast. We want the relative keys to be, if something's in A flat, we don't want the next one to start in A, or, you know, it's you want kind of things working that way. I always remember Tom Petty on Full Moon Fever, he says halfway through it, says, now if you have had an album, this is the part where you turn it over to the other side. And it was the middle of the CD.
Hello, CD listeners. We've come to the point in this album where those listening on cassette or records will have to stand up or sit down and turn over the record or tape. In fairness to those listeners, we'll now take a few seconds before we begin side two.
When it comes to the Aqua artwork, how does that process work? Do you give the artist ideas of what you're looking for, or does he come to you with a pitch?
I have a very special relationship with Rodney Matthews. Okay. And, you know, we've had covers also by Roger Dean did two covers for us.
Okay.
He did Aura and Aria. And Rodney's actually just worked on our new album cover, which is amazing for Aviana, which is our new album.
Oh, okay.
Basically with Rodney, he wanted the lyrics. And some of the songs. So he had to listen to the songs. And there was a lot of stuff about environmental stuff about man against nature. And the mechanical whale is man and the flying dolphins are nature. And he really got into that. And we're still very, very close friends, myself and Rodney Matthews.
Oh, very cool. That's interesting. I had Jack Hughes from Wang Chung was a previous guest on the show, and he told me that the guy who did the artwork for his albums was a very close friend, too. And it's just very cool to see artists, you know, collaborating on stuff like
it's
that.
It's all a team. It's
yeah,
a team,
absolutely.
Particularly back in those days, your artwork was exceedingly important.
Right.
Whereas now, you know, it's not really so important.
Were there albums when you were a kid that you have distinct memories of grabbing from the record store and being crazy about even before you heard the music?
Not before I heard the music. Always. I remember buying Live in Japan by Deep Purple. I remember buying, you know, later on, obviously, stuff like Breakfast in America and Robin Trower and early Hendrix records and Santana. I was a big fan of Santana.
Oh, yeah.
I remember buying Abraxas and playing along to Abraxas. And it's so cool. Eventually, I got to work with Greg Rowley and ended up playing Carlos's, because I play guitar as well, Carlos's guitar parts on some of those songs. So, I remember just songs of my youth, listening to the Stylistics, you know, and their falsetto stuff, or Nat King Cole, or Frank Sinatra, or Tony Bennett. My dad was getting those records when I was a kid. So we grew up in a household of music. I just remember going out to buy my own records. I think one of the ones was a single, one of the first records I bought was a single of I Shot the Sheriff by Eric Clapton.
Excellent.
and Wings.
Okay.
I remember buying Band on the Run, and I can remember the B-side now. It was, of course, a song called Zoo Gang.
Okay, yeah. Yeah, that's good stuff. Circling back to Aqua, one of the guys on that album was Al Petrelli, right? From Trans-Siberian Orchestra?
Yeah.
Yeah, how did you enjoy working with that guy?
Phenomenal guitarist. I mean, he had shades of Neil Schon in his playing, which I'm a big fan of Neil's. Very melodic, as well as just being, he's not just a rock shredder. So his tone and everything was great. I don't know. I can't remember how that we got Al. I actually don't remember. Because we had Steve Howe and Al as the two main players on that record. You know, they both play on Who'll Stop the Rain. Mm-hmm. Steve does the 12 string solo and Al does the electric solo. But great player. We've been friends. You know, he played on the next album as well, solely on Aria. And I'm glad he's doing exceedingly well with Trans-Siberian now.
You know,
he has been in Megadeth. He has been in Dixie Dregs and a few other bands.
Yeah, absolutely. Is that why he didn't stay with Asia long-term, because he had commitments with TSO?
No, I think that we went back to a UK-based band after that. And we brought in Elliot Randall from Steely Dan. And I think Al had other commitments. It was pre-TSO, I think.
Oh, okay. That makes sense. Okay. So the one other little oddity about the Aqua album is that I know there's a fan favorite on there called Lay Down Your Arms. I enjoy that track, but I read that it was used on a soundtrack for an animated movie. Do you have any memories of how that came around?
Yeah, it just came around through a manager at the time.
Okay.
And said, would we write a song? And we had a song in process on the album. I went to see the guy that had this huge budget animation about a frog that was basically James Bond.
Right.
Freddy is FR07.
Featuring music from George Benson, Patty Austin, Grace Jones, Asia, and Boy George. Colorful top quality animation, irresistible characters, and plenty of good-natured fun. The exciting animated adventures of Freddy the Frog.
And I remember in the chorus, they wanted me to sing, and Freddy says, "Lay down your arms." I was like, "No, that is not happening." So we fought them with it, and they said, "Well, we won't use your song." I said, "Well, don't use your song." But they did in the end.
Yeah.
And I remember actually having a really fun dinner with some of the executives from the movie and my father, my late father, and Ben Kingsley. Ben Kingsley was one of the voiceover guys. And that was a pretty cool moment because I'm a huge fan of Ben as an actor.
Absolutely.
So it was cool. And I went to see the movie. It was a load of crap. So I was kind of disappointed. It's this huge UK animation, and frankly, wasn't very good.
No, unfortunately, not quite like that 1981 heavy metal movie, right? Did you ever see that? That animated movie called Heavy Metal.
No.
That had a big rock soundtrack, but. Anyway, okay, so you've been rehearsing both albums. I suspect there are songs on Aqua you have not played in quite some time. Are you a little nervous about busting those out in concert?
Yeah, I mean, Heaven on Earth, I don't think we ever played live.
Okay.
Vocally, it's a lot, it's challenging. You know, it's a lot harder and higher than most of the Asia stuff.
Yeah.
Love Under Fire that Greg Lake wrote. I'm looking forward to doing.
Love under fire, we'd stand in the flame.
I like a challenge. And, you know, it's a pretty intense tour. You know, sometimes we're on four days in a row.
Oh, wow. Okay. So real packed schedule.
Yeah.
Yeah. Very good. So let's talk about the actual tour here. So if you don't want to give anything away, that's fine. But if you're headlining a show and you have the full amount of time that you're allotted, what are you hoping to, are you going to play the albums in order? What can you tell us about how you're going to build the set list?
I'm still confused about whether to actually play the album in its whole entirety and then go on from one to another or to mix it up. My initial idea was to play the whole of Aqua and then play the Asia album in reverse. And I say in reverse because you've got Only Time Will Tell and Heat at the moment at the beginning of the album. That was the thought in those days that you would always start with your strongest songs.
Right.
So I'm still thinking about that. And it would be interesting if your followers would actually help us out there. I don't know.
Post your comments in
below the video and we'll pass them on to John. I think you got a good idea there, but you're right. Isn't that an interesting thing about how albums used to be presented, where you just front load them with all the good stuff right up front?
Yeah, because you don't want people to, you know, lift the needle up and go, nah.
Right.
You know, and maybe it's not really what you wanted artistically, but it's kind of, that was a record company always leading you that way.
Yeah.
Do you expect that the set list will at least be about 50-50, or are you really going to try to do both albums all the way through?
Try and do both albums all the way through. I just have to, as my manager says, stop talking so much. I don't have a set spiel for each show, but I tend to rabbit on about anything and everything, depending on the day or the weather.
That's right. You know what's funny is I remember when I saw you back in 2017, you had like a, almost like an interview set up where all the other singers came out and chatted with you for a little bit before That's the correct. Songs. That's for what correct. It's worth, that was fun.
It was fun. It was I like doing these little concepts. You know, I had my Vegas show, which was one concept, and then I went and did, you know, a lot of these shows with different artists and trying to make them aware of what these people had done other than their greatest hits.
Right. Now, a lot of the shows on this tour, you're co-headlining, and in some shows you'll be opening the show. When you have a reduced amount of time to play, how have you figured out how you're going to factor that aspect into the set list?
It's funny you should say that. I'm actually trying to sort that out today or tomorrow.
Right.
My manager's job that he's giving me is that I've got to sort out the set list because... Yeah. You know, that there might be a show where we've got 45 minutes, 50 minutes
right.
instead of, you know, 90 minutes to 2 hours. So we'll have to adapt accordingly. And some of the shows that with another artist like Lou will probably have to front end them on the first ASIA album more. So it'd be more of a 75-25 split.
Gotcha. Well, yeah, I understand that. I mean, I got to say, I love Aqua, so I was, you know, there's going to be fans out there who are going to be cheering for Aqua no matter what, but I know you got to, you know, go with what
the. But as long as we play Heat of the Moment, and only time will tell.
Right.
They're the most important ones off the first
yeah.
album. And, you know, ideally, a lot of my tours after this anniversary tour, that's what I'd actually like to do is start playing more songs from my era, because every few years it's going to be 30th anniversary of all the other albums coming up. So
right.
really, I mean, it won't be the 30th and the 40th. So I'd probably, you know, just end up doing two big ASIA songs and the rest of it, my era.
Absolutely. That's a great idea. I think that part of the discography deserves more attention, and playing that live in concert is such a great way of introducing, you know, fans who only know the radio hits to the deeper discography. So I think that's a great idea.
Yeah.
So of course I got to ask, because, you know, you have such now an established history of collaborating with other vocalists, and you are touring with off and on a number of your rock star buddies. Do you expect, or have you talked to any of them about maybe having them come out and join you
on some of these songs from either of the two?
No, I haven't. And that's not actually a bad idea. That I do that, you know?
I think that's part of, if I may be so bold, I think that's a part of your rock and roll identity right now, is how collaborative you've been in the last number of years.
That's a great idea.
Yeah.
And I'm sure someone like Lou would do that for me.
Yes. Yes, absolutely. Cool. Okay.
Let's wrap here. We got a really good preview of the show you're going to do. I think it's a great idea. Thanks so much for coming on the show, man. I've been a fan of yours for years, and I love what you're doing.
Support. Really appreciate the support. And thank you to you and all your followers for helping us promote this show. And look forward to seeing you and the guys at the show.
Absolutely. And then we'll return for part two later on. Take care of yourself, John.
Yeah,
have a good weekend and good luck on the tour.
You too. Thank you so much.
And that was my interview with John Payne. ASIA featuring John Payne is going out on their double anniversary tour this summer, and that starts this week. The tour is celebrating both the 40th anniversary of ASIA's debut and also the 30th anniversary of Aqua, which was John's first album with ASIA. You can see tour dates and get your tickets at asiafeaturingjohnpayne.com. I need to thank John for being such a fantastic guest and for all the incredible music he's recorded over the past 30 years. As I said in the interview, one of the best things about ASIA is the scope of its discography, and there is some really great stuff from John's era in the 90s and early 2000s. And this tour is going to be a great opportunity to hear some of that stuff, so be sure to go out and see them. Also, keep an eye out for ASIA featuring John Payne's next album, Aviana, which I believe is due out this year. When we hear news about that, I will reach out to John and get him back on the show so we can talk about that project. Until then, you can find ASIA featuring John Payne on Facebook and Twitter. And as far as the future of this show goes, the next episode will be the conclusion of our Bob Dylan mini-series, Dylan Through the Decades, and that's Bob Dylan in the 2010s. I do have some more interviews planned for this summer, but I will also be doing some solo episodes as the summer winds down as well, so stay tuned for all of that. So, thank you for watching. Go see ASIA featuring John Payne this summer, and keep rocking. Hey, thanks for listening. If you enjoyed this episode, please remember the big four things you can do to support this show that don't cost a dime. Number one, listen to the show. If you're hearing this now, that means you did this part already. Thank you. There is an infinite amount of content out there, so you choosing to spend some time listening to this show means a great deal to me. Number two, if you like what we did here, please recommend this show to family, friends, or anyone you know who's looking for a podcast, particularly about music. Share our links in Facebook groups, subreddits, and recommendation threads. Whatever you can do is highly appreciated on my end. Number three, find us on social media. Follow us on Twitter at PlayThatPodcast. Like us on Facebook at facebook.com/PlayThatPodcast. And subscribe to our YouTube channel at youtube.com/C/PlayThatRockNRoll. Lots of great material, like photos and vlogs, on all three platforms, as Play That Rock and Roll is very much meant to be a content hub as well as a podcast. And finally, the big ask. Number four, please give us a 5-star rating and a positive review on Apple Podcasts or wherever you get your podcasts. I know this part is a hassle, but it really does help the show a great deal. Not just because it affects the algorithm, but also because it gives me something I can point to when pitching this show to potential guests. The more social media followers and positive ratings the show has, the better chance I have for booking high-profile guests for interviews. So if you take a moment to give us even just a 5-star rating, you are actively giving us a tool to do bigger and better things here. But whatever the case, I appreciate any and all efforts you take to support us here at Play That Rock and Roll. Be sure to join us next time for more great stories and music from the world of classic rock.